Hello, everyone. Good to see everyone back. Welcome back to Geering Up Live. Just wanted to double check. Did the intro video play through, or has it just showed up on my current page? People are saying I love the new intro. I'm glad we have an amazing team who worked on it together. So today, we're going to be exploring bubbles and surface tension, which I didn't think were as interesting as they turned out to be when I ended up doing a whole bunch of research on them. Turns out, bubbles can be fascinating. So, just a reminder, we do have our awesome chat function where you guys can talk and share ideas about the episode. Just please remember to keep your comments relevant to the stream. That would be really awesome, and it makes it so we can see all of your great questions. Also, please say hi to our moderator. We have a brand new moderator today. She is amazing. Her name is Megan. So say a big hello over in the chat. And so we're going to get into the idea of surface tension. So how we're going to start this is just something that may seem kind of basic, but it's what shape are bubbles? Like if I was just to put a whole bunch of soap in some water and stir it up really, really fast, I would get a ton of bubbles, but what shape are they normally? Are all bubbles like squares or triangles or circles or spheres? This may seem like a silly question, but it's actually really important. So I'm seeing people say spheres or round, and yeah, that is correct. But there's an interesting question here about why would a bubble be round of all shapes? Like, they could be any possible shape. Why have they all decided to be circles? Because it's not like sometimes there's a little triangular bubble in the middle of your soap, right? So that's kind of weird. So what stops it being like a hexagon or a cylinder or a star shape? Maybe a little like plus sign or a triangle. There's actually a lot of reasons that this happens, which I think is pretty cool. Someone is asking, hi, did I miss anything? We're talking about why bubbles are round, which may seem like, you know, maybe kind of a basic question, but I think there's actually a lot of really cool science behind it. So here, there's two important concepts that go into why a bubble is round. The first one is surface area, and the second one is volume. I feel like maybe you've seen before the idea of a surface area or a volume. A surface area is how much material is like around the outside of something, right? It's everything you could like touch on the outside of an object. Whereas volume is how much space that thing takes up. So the reason that bubbles are round is because spheres are this super duper cool scientific phenomena of having a really small surface area to a really big volume. So let's look at this in like a diagram. Spheres are what we call a low energy state. That means that around the outside, because the surface area is small, there's not as much sort of space for force to be applied inwards on the sphere. But because the volume inside can be so big, it pushes back out with a lot of force. This means that it doesn't actually take a whole lot of energy for everything inside to balance out anything pushing from the outside, which I think is really cool. Like, it's a little bit of fun math for you this morning. And so we see, or like we could think about this, like imagine you were picking up a house. It would be really hard to pick up a house by yourself. But imagine you had 200 people together trying to pick up a house. That might be a little bit easier. Or if you had 1,000 people, that would be easier than that. Now imagine instead you had something that weighed the same as a house, but it was the size of as a car, right? You could maybe get 1,000 people to pick that up and it would be even easier. That's kind of the idea, is that the less area there is for force to be applied, the easier it is for stuff to hold it back out. So going on from there, you might wonder, well, like, is this only bubbles? Like, does everything behave this way? And it's true. This always happens. So, think about if you kick a soccer ball and you're standing somewhere with lots of hills. Soccer balls will always go to where something is lowest. Like, if you kick it down a hill, it won't stay put. It'll roll down to the bottom and stay at the bottom. Or if you heat up hot chocolate in a microwave and then you leave it out for a couple of hours, it ends up being the same temperature as the room. Or if you take a magnet, you put it near another magnet, it won't stay where they're not aligned. They'll snap to being pointed in opposite directions. So this comes from all sorts of different fields of science. I know we've talked a lot about particles and atoms in our previous live streams. So things even like electrons, they always stay in the lowest energy state if you like just left their own devices. It's very hard to find in nature some random particle that's going really, really, really fast if it didn't get a bunch of energy added to it. Things like hot chocolate cooling down, that happens from thermodynamics, where things will settle down into the lowest energy state they can. This happens in every field of science. This is universal. So here's a thing. I'm going to ask you, and you can put things in the comments. So imagine someone tells you, you have to stay in the same position until someone comes to get you or to say hi to you next. This could take 10 minutes, 20 minutes, an hour, 2 hours. I want you to think about what would make you, what would take the least energy for you? Would you like stand up, both your hands straight up in the air? Or would you get down and hold a push-up position? Or would you just lie down? What do you think would be easiest? What would make you the least tired? So you can put things in the comments as what you think would be the easiest thing for you to do that would take, you know, you would use the least amount of energy. Yeah, you're all saying lie down. Exactly the same. You're following the same principle that happens with electrons, with a soccer ball rolling down the hill, with your hot chocolate cooling down. All of it's the same. You're in your lowest energy state when you're lying down. But now, here's a really cool thing that can happen. So depending on the system that you're in, the system being, you know, you and your surrounding environment, or, you know, your cup of hot chocolate and your kitchen, or your soccer ball and your hill, depending on this thing that we call a system, if you change it in different ways, then you can actually make the lowest energy state change. So let's think about this. If you were on the space station, for example, so if you're on the ISS and you're floating around in zero gravity, if you're standing up or lying down, there's the same amount of force on your body, right? Because there's no gravity. So in something like the space station, lying down and standing up are actually like the same state. So in the same way, we can change what we're used to having as the lowest energy state for a system, and we're going to do this with bubbles. So we're going to use surface tension to sort of change our lowest energy state, and we're going to change our little environment or our system that our soap is in to make a different lowest energy state than a sphere. And I'm actually going to make a bubble for you that's a cube, which I think is super duper cool. So going from this, how do you think we're going to make a bubble that isn't a sphere? We have to change the system somehow to make it so that forming a box is going to be the lowest possible energy state, and the bubble's going to want to be a sphere. How do you think we're going to do that? Because, you know, we don't see them when we're doing the dishes or, you know, like when you lather up your shampoo. You don't see a cubic bubble. So how do you think we could go about that? Mehar says, maybe blow it through a square bubble wand. That's a great place to start. Yeah, so if we have a square bubble wand, then the little soap film inside is going to be definitely a square when it's in the frame. That's true. Do we have any other ideas or thoughts about maybe like transfigure it with a wand? You know, that's pretty much on the right track. We're gonna take what we're used to with a bubble wand, and we're going to kind of transform it and make ourselves something new that's actually going to be a cube. But before we get into that, someone says make the soap thicker. Also important, but I don't actually have glycerin at my house. Megumi says, I don't think it works because I had a star shape and it was not a star. You know, just having a star shape or square shape bubble won't necessarily make your end bubble turn out as a star shape or a square shape bubble. But we're going to do some sneaky little 3D magic, and we're actually going to make a cubic bubble. But before we get into that, I want to talk really quick about just what a bubble is, because when I was researching how to do this experiment, I was completely blown away because I didn't know anything about how a bubble formed. I just thought it was soap. So a bubble is made of three layers. There's soap molecules actually trap water in between them. And so when you have a bubble that forms from like blowing in your bubble wand, there's actually water trapped inside, which I thought was really, really cool. So soap molecules have two ends. They have a hydrophobic end and a hydrophilic end. These words might seem really big. Yeah, people are saying it isn't just soap. Yeah, no, it's not just soap. It's actually a little soap water sandwich that uses surface tension to hold itself together. That's not the right slide. That's fine. So a hydrophobic end means that it's scared of water. It doesn't want to touch the water. And a hydrophilic end means it loves the water. So the ends that love water grab onto the water particles in the middle, which means the ends that hate water push away from it, and that's how bubbles form on the surface of stuff. That's why when you mix up soapy water, you don't end up with bubbles in the bottom. It's because they trap all that air, it's a little bit lighter, and it pushes it all the way up to the top because it doesn't want to be around the rest of the water, which I think is super duper cool. So, it's my favorite time of a stream. We're going to get into the safety check. For this experiment, the only thing you need to do is to make sure that when you're making your little apparatus to make square bubbles, you have to be really careful. Because sometimes if you're trying to cut wires or other things to make a cube, it could cut your hands. Like, I know I accidentally cut my finger while I was trying to do this, which was very silly and I shouldn't have done it. So do it with a parent or wear gloves. So what you're gonna need to do, here, we're gonna go through, whoop. You're gonna need anything bendy, anything you can move around, like pipe cleaners or straws. I made mine with wire, but you've got to be really, really careful with that because wire cutters are really strong and really sharp. And then we need to make some bubble liquid. So if you have some at home, you can just use it. But if you want to make some, I didn't have any, so I had to make some. You need 6 parts of water, or 6 parts soap. That's silly. I wrote that backwards. It's 6 parts water to 1 part soap. Clearly, I need to learn to proofread. So you're gonna need, I used 6 cups of water to 1 cup of soap. You can add something called glycerin if you want to. It makes it thicker. Pardon me. But I didn't have any glycerin at my house, and it works just fine without it. So when you have your bubble liquid, you're gonna make a cube with your wire or pipe cleaner or anything. Mine's kind of ugly because I made it out of a coat hanger because it's the only wire I could find in my house. But you want to form this cube up top. So now, once we've done our safety check, so make sure if you're going to make one of these and you're using anything that's kind of sharp, make sure to do it with a parent so that you don't accidentally cut yourself with wire cutters, this is important. So I have my kind of ugly but doing its best cube. It's formed here. And I have, thank you for my coat hanger cube. It took me like 35 minutes and I was sweaty and struggling and it was really hard. So the thing that I am going to do is tie my hair back because I don't want it to end up in the soapy water. My bright yellow scrunchie. So my hair is back and out of the way. And I have my cube and I have my bowl here of bubble water, which I'm not going to tilt because I don't want to spill it all over my computer. So now all I'm going to do is take my little bubble apparatus and dunk it down in my water, same as you would if you were making bubbles any other time. See, we're just going to swirl it around in here. And now what's going to happen is when I pull it back out, there's a square. I've made a square bubble in the middle of my cube. So now let's dunk it in again and see if we can make another one. Let's pop this ones on the side. We don't need those. Check that out. We've made a square bubble in the middle of our cube. Look. It's a fully cubic bubble. We changed the system, and now what should have been a spherical bubble is actually a cube. We've completely changed the system and what the lowest energy state is, and we were able to make, oh my, people are saying how much bubble water that is. I had to make it big enough so I could dunk my cube in all the way, and I made a pretty big cube. If you make a smaller cube, you can make less bubble liquid. So, I think that's pretty amazing. I've been making cubic bubbles for like the entire week. I've been so excited. But yeah, we can make completely cube-shaped bubbles. You were saying my reality is collapsing. That's so funny. So, I'm going to show you one more time. I'm just popping the bubbles that are stuck to it on the inside right now because I twirled it too fast. But here we go. Here's just a square. See, it's flat if we look at it this way, but we've made a square. Maybe it's easier to show against my shirt or the back wall. But this one is completely square. And if we dunk it in again, pop the one on the side, we get a cube. Look at that. It's a three-dimensional cubic bubble, which I think is pretty, pretty amazing. Now, you can do this with a cube because you've completely changed the system, and we're about to talk about how this happens. So, one more fun fact before I flip away to tell you how this happens, but trying to dunk this enough so I get my cube back. So, this cube that we see here, where it looks like there's a cube inside of another cube, this is also how this is like just sort of a fun fact that I think is super interesting. But that cube inside of a cube, or the thing you see right here on the side of my screen, is also how scientists draw four-dimensional cubes called tesseracts. Remember tesseract from like, you know, the Avengers, they talk about the tesseract. So like the visual representation scientists use to draw 4D cubes is exactly what we just made with my like wire bubble wand, which I think is just insane. So we used a little bit of transfiguration to turn our normally just square bubble wand into a cube bubble wand. And then we made a cube that like a bubble that normally shouldn't exist in nature, which is super duper cool. I might say this wrong, but Eyeballistic Squid said, why does it make a smaller cube inside? We're gonna talk about that right now. You're actually way ahead of me on this. So, how does it stay square? So you know how I talked about how when a bubble forms, you get that soap, water, soap, little sandwich. Right? We call that a film or your soap film. So this stays together because of surface tension. So surface tension is other things being able to pull on each other to stay together. And that's why when you're drinking a cup of water, it looks like it's sticking to the sides of your cup. So in this case, it sticks to all the different sides. Here, I'm going to bring my cube back over so I can show this. It's going to stick to every side of my cube. And then it looks, it's like looking around for other things. And because there is soap inside of it, the shortest distance, the lowest energy state that my cube, like all the soap in my cube can be in, is it grabs onto the outside and then it grabs onto something in the middle in a straight line. And that's why we get that cube forming inside, is because in this new system where we can make cubic bubbles, the shortest distances and the way it can take the least energy to hold itself together is by forming a square. Which I think everyone's saying, this is magic, this is crazy. I thought it was magic too. I saw this experiment on TV when I was probably like 10 years old. It was on the Discovery Channel. And I have been thinking about it for like 13 years. I've been like all the time, whenever I get a chance to make one or do a demo or talk to my friends about it, I think it is like super duper cool and totally changes like what I'm used to doing. And so while things in nature don't necessarily regularly form a cubic bubble, this idea of surface tension is actually used everywhere. So how many of you have seen these little like bugs on a pond? We call them like water striders, or I don't know other names for them. I always called them water striders. That's like what my mom called them. So these little bugs are much smarter than you would think to believe, because they're like, you know, a bug. And they actually use the same idea of having particular shapes and surface tension so that they can go across the water really fast and they don't sink. So they have these long, thin legs, and then the end there look a little bit broader. And so that shape of their legs kind of works in the same way that our cube did, because it makes it so that the surface tension isn't broken and they can spread out just like the soap did in our cube. And this is how they can walk on water. You and I can't walk on water because our feet are way too small for how big our bodies are, for how much our mass is. But water striders are super light and they can spread their mass out and have these long, thin legs. And so they're actually able to use surface tension to walk on water, which is like, I think that's super duper amazing. So what did we talk about today? Quick recap. We're going to do a ready, set, recap. Bubbles are made of this little soap, water, soap sandwich on the outside. And there's a hydrophobic, scared of water, and hydrophilic end. And so the hydrophobic end is what pushes it away and makes it sit on the surface of like a pond or water or like dishes in your sink or your shampoo. So bubbles are almost always spheres because in nature, spheres are the lowest energy state. But if we change the system or change the conditions that our soap is in, we can actually completely change what the lowest energy state of the system is. So we can make a cubic bubble if we use a totally different supporting structure. And this happens because of surface tension and how strong the bonds between the soap water little sandwiches are to hold it together. So at the end of this, I'm happy to take some questions, but before we get there, just want to remind you, we are still always taking signups for our daily activity clubs. It's 1.5 to 2 hours a day. You do all sorts of different STEM activities. So, you know, you can watch me do demos, but you can also do them at home. If a bursary is something that would make this more accessible for you, that's always available. So you can visit gearinguponline.ca, and if you want to join us for some awesome activities, you're always welcome. And as always, thank you so much for watching Gearing Up Live. It is some of our favorite parts of the day just to be able to come on and show you guys amazing science. I had so much fun exploring bubbles and surface tension with you all. Megan has been an amazing co-host, so make sure to give her lots of love in the chat. And as always, I'll stick around to answer any questions you have. And if I can't answer them, I will always try to get to them in our Q&A videos, which I don't think is, it's obviously not this Friday because today is Friday, but I think next Friday we're doing a Q&A, and so if there's any questions that I don't know the answer to today, we'll try to get to you in my Q&A next week. So thank you so much. It has been amazing. Make sure to tune in tomorrow because we're doing an episode all about balance, which I don't naturally have. So I think it's going to be really interesting. I'll be watching to learn way more about it. So if anyone has any questions, I will stick around right now. Someone said, in cartoons, they show the character getting trapped in giant bubbles. Is that possible? It's a good question. I think you'd have to have a really, really strong bubble. If you have a bubble liquid that has a lot of glycerin in it, so it's really thick and really strong, you can put bubbles inside of other bubbles. But I think they would have to be, like, incredibly strong bubbles to put something that was actually heavy, like a person in it, and still have it float. I don't think that's possible, like to my understanding it isn't, but I don't know, so I will probably Google it after this to learn more about it, and I can always add that to our stream on next Friday. I think it would have to be like a really, really strong bubble, and I don't think you'd be able to fly afterwards. Megumi said, could you do that experiment with another shape? So I actually did make one that was a triangle. It doesn't form a triangle inside, but you do get really cool, just like triangular panels that I'm happy to go grab and show you. Give me 1 second. It's not expecting to have to grab this, so. I made one that was a little triangular prism. It's also made out of a coat hanger, so it's kind of, it's doing its best. But when you dunk this one in the water, you don't get a, you don't get any kind of shape forming inside, but you do get these, like, thin bubble films. It's quite hard to show on camera. That form between it, and so you make, like, flat triangular edges, but nothing forms in the middle. Someone's saying, can you make bubbles as big as a house? Well, let's think about that. You would need some kind of like bubble apparatus that was super big, because that usually contributes to how big the end bubble is. So if you started with quite a big like bubble wand, and you had really, really strong bubble solution. It had lots and lots of glycerin in it, and it was really, really sturdy. I know you can, like, I've seen videos of people blowing bubbles that were like the size of a person, but I feel like a house might be pushing the limit. I think you'd have to, like, talk to someone in, like, chemical engineering to design, like, the perfect bubble solution. Sounds like a Mark Rober video, honestly. I wonder if someday he'll do it. But yeah, if you make like super big bubble wand and like super duper stable bubble solution, I think you could make pretty big bubbles. I don't know if they would ever be the size of a house. But maybe one day, go to university, join a chemical engineering team, and set out about making a massive bubble. Whoa, Megan just commented and said the world record is 50 feet long and 2 feet in diameter. So 2 feet in diameter is like, you know, that big, kind of. And then super duper long. So they make like long cylinder kind of shape, or like oval shaped bubbles. Doesn't seem anyone's made a massive spherical bubble yet. Someone said they're blowing bubbles in a park with a rope. Yeah, you can do that if you tie the end together and then drag it through the air really quickly, you can make bubbles. Someone's saying, Henrietta is asking, how big would a bubble have to have the world in it? Well, the world is, I think, like 17,000 kilometers in diameter. something like that. So you would need a bubble that was at least the size of the world to be able to fit it inside. Can you make a bubble that cannot pop? Yes, you can. There are lots of awesome tutorials online to make quote-unquote unpoppable bubbles. I actually saw some recently that were sort of made, I think they were sort of like naturally made, and they were from seafoam algae. And even though they'd been like in the sun for days and days and they hadn't been near the water, the bubbles were still solid. So that can form out of algae sometimes, but there's lots of tutorials online about how to make them at home. Someone's saying, can you make a rectangle? Absolutely, you can make a rectangle. You just need a rectangular bubble device instead of a square one. Although squares are technically rectangles. I think that's most of the questions for today. It is 11:30. I know lots of you go have lunch after this, so don't let me cut into your lunchtime. But thank you so much for joining us today. I thought this was super fun. I'm always so grateful to see that mix of familiar icons and then new people joining the stream. It's awesome. So I'm going to sign off. This has been so much fun. Super happy you're all here. I will see you again on Tuesday. But on Monday, we have an awesome episode on balance coming up. So, bye-bye. Bye, Mehar. Bye, EB. Bye, Megumi. Judy will sing tie a rope to a bunch of planets. You could try. I don't know if you could try. I don't know if ropes can be that strong. Goodbye, Claire. Thank you, Megumi. I love streaming for you guys. I think it's amazing. Bye, Henrietta. Goodbye, Tree Tangled. Okay, I'm gonna sign off. Later.